Hodder and Stoughton Limited presents Your Best Friend by Julie Corbin. Read by Rose Robinson. Prologue. She's running through the woods, gulping cold air that stings her throat and makes her cough. She feels him behind her, and her heart doubles its speed, but her legs can't go any faster. When he catches hold of her hair, she screams, yanks herself free, then pushes back into his chest. He grunts several times, sounding so much like a pig that she has to stifle the hysteria wedged tight against the fear in her chest. She pushes him again, and he loses his balance, slithers down the bank to one side of them. There is the crack of twigs, the dull thump of thigh bone and elbow, the scrape of flesh on stone. And all the while he's cursing, howling her name into the darkness like a wolf to the full moon. Seconds of falling, and then a loud splash as his body comes to rest in the stream. She waits, her heart ticking, her knees shaking. A huge shiver passes through her. Wide-eyed, she holds her breath and listens, tuning into sounds beyond herself. The soft shuffle of small mammals and insects, the breath of wind trailing through the leaves and lifting single strands of her hair. When she's satisfied that enough time has passed, she follows his fall down the bank, not sliding as he did, but carefully placing one foot in front of the other, stretching out blindly to grasp hold of tree roots and rocks to keep her steady. She reaches the bottom and blinks into the gloom, before spotting the body-shaped lump in the stream. She shivers again when she imagines him crawling towards her, silent as a snake, to wrap his hands around her ankles and pull her underground. But as she edges closer, she sees that he can't crawl, that movement would be impossible. His limbs are twisted, his pelvis raised at one side, the angle unnatural. She feels sure his left knee has popped from its socket. There is the dark stain of blood on his temple. His eyelids flutter open, then close again, as he hovers in the space between the conscious and the unconscious. The air is heavy here, off the beaten track, where dangerous possibilities lurk. She feels this significance move through her in a wave of heat. Here, chance and opportunity collide. No one is watching. With quick, rough hands, she digs aside the pebbles beneath his head. An inch more depth and his head drops further back, his ears, his cheeks, and finally his nose and mouth sinking under the water. He breathes in the stream and coughs. Startled, his eyes open fully this time, and she catches his panic. Her indrawn breath caught short as her hand flies to her throat. Should she? Shouldn't she? She stands away from him, watching as he tries to lift himself up. He almost manages, gives a growl of desperation when he fails. She hesitates for a split second before placing her foot high up on his chest, leaning in until all her weight is over this one foot. He gurgles, tries for the last time to lift his mouth to the air, his bloody knuckled hands failing to grasp the shoe pressing down on him. When he's quiet, she watches him for a full, unconscionable minute before blowing on her hands to warm them. Then she retraces her steps back to the village, the moon's glare highlighting her flushed cheeks. Lydia. My stomach was in knots. The agent had a list of 5 couples interested in renting our house, and the first was due to arrive any minute. "They'll snap it up," the agent had said to me earlier that afternoon, her tone determinedly upbeat. "It's exactly what they're looking for." I'd spent 2 weeks putting off all viewings by inventing important meetings, a plumbing catastrophe, and a strange smell in the basement. The agent had offered to show the house while I was at my meetings, contact a plumber on my behalf, spray air freshener in the basement. I refused all offers of help and told her I would call her back ASAP. I didn't call her back, and so she had bypassed me completely and spoken directly to Zach. He was genuinely perplexed.
What's going on, Lydia? Why didn't you tell me about these issues? What am I missing here?
I didn't want to trouble you. He was staying weeknights at his mum's house in Sussex. She'd recently been admitted to the hospice where she was receiving end-of-life care. The smell was easily sorted, but I didn't want prospective renters sloshing through water from a burst pipe, I told him.
What pipe? When? How?
The Pattersons had the same issue, I said quickly. Since when had lying come so easily to me?
Who are the Pattersons?
They live at number 12, I told him. We went round there last year for a curry. I could almost hear his brain ticking over. She made the most delicious samosas.
Oh, yeah, I remember now. Then they had a cinema room on the top floor.
Anyway, I took a breath. They were about to begin a similar extension to ours, and we talked about the plans. I exaggerated a story about their builder who had referenced ground level issues and an ancient stream that ran beneath the street. So it's probably to do with the angle of the pipes, the plumber thinks, and with all the rain we've been having. I trailed off. Fortunately, Zach had other things on his mind, so he didn't pick over the details.
The sooner you and Adam join me down here, the better, he'd said. I miss you.
And I miss you, I'd replied. It was true. I did miss him. But that didn't mean I wanted to move to Ashdown Village. I'd agreed to do it because I never really expected it to happen. And now, here I was, dragging my feet, hoping for a reprieve. Not because I didn't care about Paula. She had always been a wise and supportive mother-in-law, and I was closer to her than I'd ever been to my own mother. Every day since she'd been admitted to the hospice, we'd messaged each other. I'd send her photos and videos of Adam and his friends, links to articles I'd read on the internet that I knew she'd enjoy, and funny videos of animals or toddlers. She never made me feel as if I was letting her down by not visiting. But life was all about timing, wasn't it? And she did have a terminal diagnosis. She could pass away at any moment. That wasn't what I was hoping for. It was simply the reality. I knew that these were thoughts I couldn't voice. I would be too ashamed to say them out loud. Zach was a good son. That was one of the many reasons I loved him. To know that his wife was anticipating his mum's death, that would break his heart and make me the worst sort of person. Someone who puts herself before others. A selfish bitch. I picked Adam's jacket up off the floor and hung it on one of the hooks by the front door. He wasn't happy at his London school and had gone to Sussex with Zach for a trial day at a school close to the village. He was excited at the thought of moving out of London.
It'll be great living in the country, Mum, won't it? And we can see Grandma more.
Adam adored his grandma. Zach's dad had passed away just after Adam was born, and his mum had come to stay with us, often for months at a time, caring for Adam while Zach and I were working. I loved that they had such a close bond. Losing her was going to be hard on him. I went through to the living room and half-heartedly plumped the sofa cushions. The room was a mess. As a rule, we weren't tidy people, and with Zach barely here, I'd given up all pretense of clearing up. There were empty wine glasses and coffee cups all over the surfaces. A thin layer of dust was accumulating, and the room smelt stale. I hadn't baked any bread, and there were no fresh flowers on the mantelpiece. It struck me that the house had never been so unwelcoming, and I was hoping that the couple coming for the viewing would hate it. The bell rang, and I opened the front door. Sorry. I kicked several pairs of shoes out of their way. There never seems to be quite enough space in the hallway. Mandy was all smiles as she introduced them both.
Hi, I'm Mandy, and this is my husband Fergal.
I didn't return her smile. My head was too full of noise.
This is so lovely,
Mandy said, stepping onto the black and white floor tiles and stretching her arms out either side of her. She was classically beautiful, a modern Grace Kelly, the sort of woman whom everyone looked at twice.
Much more room than we have at the moment.
She walked to the bottom of the stairs, her ponytail bouncing with each step.
I love the shape of this staircase.
There were books, shoes, and clothes on practically every step, but she saw past it all, her eyes following the graceful curve upwards. Any downsides to living here? Fergal asked me. He was small and bald, with a pointy chin. People would have looked at them both and said he was punching well above his weight, but I knew better than to judge any book by its cover.
When you have visitors, it'll be really hard for them to park, I said, then shook my head. Impossible, in fact, it's a nightmare.
It's like that all over London though, isn't it?
Mandy replied, undaunted. She pulled at Fergal's upper arm.
Don't you just love the cupola?
He followed her eyes and stared up two flights to the dome-shaped glass ceiling and the blue sky beyond. Wow, he said. That's quite something.
It makes the house hard to heat, I said.
Our bills have doubled in the last few years.
We can wear layers, Mandy replied. I love a cashmere sweater.
Let's go down to the kitchen. I ushered them ahead of me. I'm afraid it's smaller than some of the others in the street. Mandy paused twice on the staircase to reference small details that caught her attention before gasping as she entered the kitchen diner.
It's so perfect,
she breathed. I watched her eyes mist over. She turned to Fergal, and they discussed entertaining in a space like this, with all this natural light.
It's south-facing, isn't it?
She asked me. I nodded. My arms were folded, and I used my foot to nudge a bin bag of empty wine and spirit bottles, pushing the bag into the recess between the fridge and the breakfast bar. Had I really drunk that much in a week? Mandy walked past me into the garden, and I prodded the bag a little more, the bottles clinking loudly. I gave Fergal a meaningful glance, as if to say this will happen to you if you live here.
Hydrangeas,
Mandy called out, chirpy as a cheerleader. And then,
I've always wanted to live in a house with a walled garden.
I let them both linger over the magnolia tree and pots of hydrangeas before taking them upstairs. We'd seen two of the bedrooms when Mandy said,
the agent told us there's a good chance you'll list the house.
Sorry. I swallowed awkwardly, my mouth dry.
That you'll most likely stay in Sussex and put the house up for sale?
No. I shook my head. No, no. No, I repeated, more forcefully this time. The house will only be rented out for a year, and then we'll be moving back.
Oh.
She smiled, her expression uncertain.
Okay.
I stood in the hallway while they wandered through the master bedroom. Why had the agent said that? If Zach had told her we'd sell the house within the year, then that wasn't what we'd agreed. He had been travelling back and forth for almost a month when he bumped into one of his old school friends.
Remember Crofty? He'd asked me. It was great to see him again.
They met up for a game of golf, and the next thing, Zach was convinced that we should move back to his home village.
He was all for putting our house on the market at once.
What's stopping us?
Our lives are here, and you're making it work, living in your mum's house during the week. Upping sticks and moving, that would be...
Not really, Lydia,
he interrupted, a sad frown on his face.
There's barely room for me at mum's. The house is full of stuff, you know what it's like.
I nodded. His mum was a bit of a hoarder.
All the travelling up and down, and I want Adam to spend as much time with mum as he can.
His voice wavered.
She's the only grandparent he has.
I'd already suggested that she come to live with us, but she needed specialist nursing care. So I agreed to the move. What else could I do? Especially as Adam was all for it. But I didn't want to completely let go of the house.
We'd sell this place overnight, Lydia. You know that,
Zach had said wearily. But buying and selling can take months. It's all the stuff that goes with it. Lawyers and surveys and to-ing and fro-ing with one thing and another.
Okay,
he acknowledged.
Let's rent ours out and find something down there.
That was our agreement. Mandy and Fergal finished their tour of the bedrooms, and I took them back to the front door. We love your home, she said to me, her eyes wide with sincerity. We'll speak to the agent straight away. She joined her hands as if praying. Please consider us. We promise to look after it. I will. Thank you. I closed the door behind them and ran downstairs to the kitchen. I took a bottle of vodka from the freezer and a shot glass from the cupboard. I poured 3 shots one after the other, swallowing the liquid with a shudder, before collapsing onto the floor next to the bin bag, my knees pulled up to my chest. How could I have let this happen? I thought I'd been so clever. I thought I could erase my past with omissions, deflections, and the odd, well-timed lie. But here I was, about to go back to the worst place in the world, and there was nothing, short of leaving my husband and son, that I could do about it. You could be honest, a small voice whispered. Imagine that. I poured another shot of vodka and knocked it back. But now the alcohol was swirling in my blood, and I felt relaxation spreading through the muscles in my arms and legs. The voices in my head were quieter, the pain in my heart subdued. I drifted off with my thoughts, remembering how Zach and I met one Thursday evening in a too trendy bar in Camden, the place heaving with rowdy 20-somethings. While his date was on her mobile and mine had gone to the loo to hook up with his dealer, we got chatting about how out of place we felt. We were both in our early 30s and neither of us were drinking. And then I asked, where are you from?
A village south of Gatwick. You won't have heard of it.
Try me, I said, never for one moment expecting him to say,
Ashdown Village.
I froze. My breath stopped. Ice spread through my skull. Zach didn't notice my reaction because he was distracted by a crowd at the end of the bar who were playing drinking games. When he looked back at me, I was able to draw breath and paste a smile on my face.
Gone are the days when I could drink like that.
My breath stopped again, but this time it was for a good reason. He held my eyes, and an understanding passed between us. I found you. You're mine.
Of all the bars in all the world, he said.
We both grinned and then laughed. I felt a flood of relief, from terror to safety in the blink of an eye.
Do you fancy going somewhere quieter?
We abandoned our dates and left together. When, a few weeks later, he introduced me to his home village,
I kept my smile on full beam and my fear locked down. And when we became a couple, I always found reasons to invite his parents to our house. They loved visiting London, so were more than happy to make the journey, watch a show, stay overnight, and visit the less tourist-heavy streets. Years had passed, and it was far too late, to be honest, not without causing Zach to question everything I had ever said. I was going to have to tough it out as best I could. My mobile rang, and I looked at the screen. Zach. Hi, love.
Mum, it's me. Guess what?
What? I smiled at the excitement in Adam's voice.
The school's amazing. They play games every afternoon. There are four pitches, and my form teacher said I'm good enough to get into the football team in the village.
That's great news, Adam. I was two people. The mum who was pleased that her son was happy, and the woman who was scared witless of returning to a place she'd sworn she would never live in again.
And because it's only the second week of term, the teacher says I can easily catch up with the work.
Okay. I didn't want to burst his bubble and say that we weren't thinking of moving there until November at the earliest.
And I met Jenny, who's been helping Gran at the hospice. She invited us back to her house, and it was really brilliant. She has loads of Lego and a big garden where the deer come in.
Zach had told me about Jenny. She was a volunteer at the hospice and had taken Paula and Zach under her wing. And now, by the sounds of it, Adam, too.
Dad wants to talk to you.
Okay, love. I'll see you tomorrow.
Good news on the rental, Zach said without preamble. It'll be ready in a week, 2 months earlier than we thought.
Fuck. Adam's really happy about it, and so is Mum. He left a pause for me to fill.
Are you there?
He asked.
Yes, I heard you.
We'd spent one long Saturday viewing houses, and I'd found fault with all of them. Finally, I had to give way when we looked around one that both Zach and Adam were enthusiastic about. It had generous family rooms, was in a prime location, and with an established garden big enough for a mini football pitch. I couldn't argue with any of it, but still I'd tried. It's very modern. I pointed to the spread of glass and huge cement blocks. I'm not sure I like it.
Easy to heat and to clean. Everything works. It'll make a change from a Victorian townhouse.
I like our house.
You can like both, Debbie Downer,
Zach had said, exasperated.
It's not as if we're buying it.
I'd given in when the owner said they wouldn't be moving out until the beginning of November. But now, here we were with a date. Next week. I poured another vodka shot.
How were the couple who came to view our place?
Zach asked.
Nice.
Do they want to rent it?
I think so. And then I remembered.
They also seemed to think they'd be able to buy it at some point soon.
Well, it's likely we'll find somewhere permanent down here, isn't it?
No, I'm not.
I tried to catch hold of a reason, but the booze was clouding my mind.
I like our house. I've never wanted to live in the country.
The pollution, the rush, the expense, the traffic noise. London has so much to offer, he said dryly.
We live in a quiet street. We have lovely friends.
Why can't you see this as an opportunity, Lydia?
He lowered his voice.
For fuck's sake, do you think I want any of this? Do you think I want my mum to be dying?
Of course not.
Stop making this such a battle.
I'm trying, I said quietly. I really am.
We said our goodbyes, and my hand went up to my neck, but there was no clothing there to loosen. The tight feeling was lodged inside my throat, a lump that wouldn't dissolve no matter how much liquid I used to wash it away. I was on a runaway train, with no way for me to get off. Tess. The numbers. They just never seemed to add up anymore. Or, to be more accurate, the debit column was always hundreds, sometimes thousands of pounds greater than the credit column. It was 5 years since she'd started her company, Maids of Honor. Nothing to do with weddings, which she knew caused some confusion. But she was really stuck on the name, and people soon got it. The Honor referred to the cleaning products they used. Everything was biodegradable and planet-friendly. She cleaned houses for a living. It wasn't glamorous work, but until recently, it had helped pay her share of the household bills. Now, with only one salary and her dad's pension, making ends meet was nigh on impossible. She felt the baby kick, and her hand automatically strayed down to her pregnant belly. She would have to take out another loan to tide them over until she could grow the business. It wasn't fair to ask her dad for more money. He would dig into his savings if he knew she was desperate, but he was helping her out more than enough as it was. Why in God's name hadn't she and Steve got life insurance? Because they had thought they were invincible. That's why. They had never imagined that either of them would die. They were only in their 40s. It was inconceivable. Until it wasn't. Steve had died 7 months ago, but Tess felt like she'd been grieving for years. And at the same time, it was as if it had only happened yesterday. Every day was a fearful, endless grind, dragging herself out of bed, getting dressed, going through the motions of home and work, trying to find meaning in day-to-day activities, trying and failing, because every action and every thought led back to Steve. She was 38 weeks pregnant, and while she felt blessed to be carrying his baby, she was dreading giving birth. Steve got her through Bobby's delivery, cheering her on when she felt as if it was all too much. "Could I have more gas and air? Could someone please, please just knock me out and pull out my son because I'm not strong enough to do this?" Steve had coaxed her on, breathing along with her until Bobby was born and they became a family. But this baby, their daughter, would be one of those children who'd never know her dad. She'd be familiar with him through photographs, video clips, and memories that were shared with her, but she would never truly know him. She wouldn't experience the warmth of his smile, his hand holding hers as she walked into school, the joy of being thrown up into the air by a dad who would always catch her. Tess blinked back tears and refreshed the spreadsheet, but it made no difference. Takings were down, not just because they'd lost some clients, but because two of her six strong cleaning team had left and she hadn't had the energy to interview for replacements. Vanya had kept things ticking over, and Tess was grateful for that. But a business didn't run itself. "I need a strategy," she said out loud. For the umpteenth time, she wished that Steve was here beside her, her life partner forever and a day. Before he passed away, in one of their lighter moments, they joked about her getting a t-shirt that said, "What would Steve do?" As far as parenting went, Steve was far more confident than she was. He seemed to know exactly how to pitch it. The balance between keeping Bobby close and tossing him in at the deep end was something he instinctively got right. "I know what I'll do," he'd said to her one day after a chemo session. "I'll write you letters." She asked him not to, because she felt that the very act of writing the letters was an invitation to death, an admission that he was giving up. But he wrote them anyway, and left them in a shoebox for her. There were over 20 of them, some of them dated for future birthdays. Others had titles such as Being a Parent or When You're Unsure What to Do Next. There wasn't a letter titled Strategy for Maids of Honor, but she didn't really need one. She could hear Steve's voice saying, Word of mouth will get you so far, Tess, but every now and then you'll need to put an ad in one of the local papers. Sound advice, she muttered. She would advertise in the local magazine, the free one that was delivered to all the houses in the village. She needed to make the advert eye-catching, punchy. She couldn't afford to invest in a whole page spread, so a standout font and bright colours were vital. She began to design the copy on her laptop, losing herself in the task until she heard the front door open and close, and her dad came into the kitchen. What are you doing still up? He bent to kiss her cheek. You should be resting. She glanced at the clock on the wall. It was gone 11. I've been carried away doing this. She turned the laptop screen towards him. I need to drum up some more business. A quarter-page ad in the Ashdown Village magazine could work. What do you think? Her dad's lips moved silently as he read the copy.
I think that's brilliant, Tess. Most people can't resist a bargain. 20% off sounds like a winner to me.
Thanks, Dad. She closed the lid of her laptop. How was your evening?
The usual. Snooker and a pint. Old bloke shooting the breeze.
I thought you were going on a date.
So did I. He looked bashful. But she didn't show.
Her dad hadn't had a permanent partner since he and her mum had separated, way back when she was 10. When Steve was alive, they had encouraged him to find someone new. Now, though, Tess knew she was being selfish, but it would be the worst sort of timing if he suddenly fell in love. Dad, she stood up and gave him a hug. Whoever she is, she's a fool. You're a gift for any woman. She drew back and smiled at him. Mind you, I don't know what I'd do without you.
You and Bobby and that baby in there are my priority for now.
He looked down at her pregnant belly.
Catch some sleep while you can. If this baby is anything like Bobby was, you'll be waving goodbye to an undisturbed night for at least 3 years.
Oh, God, don't remind me. Tess rolled her eyes. Bobby didn't sleep all night until he was almost 4. She and Steve used to spend hours pacing the floor or trying to tire him out with games, searching for reasons for his wakefulness. Was it them? Were they really hopeless parents? The health visitor had assured them that wasn't the case. Some babies were just like that. Tess was praying she'd have better luck second time around. All the more important when she was an older mother with no partner. At times, she felt all of her 46 years and some. She said goodnight to her dad and climbed the stairs. Before she went into her own room, she checked on Bobby. His bedroom was compact, his bed pushed up against the wall so that his Lego models could have free rein on the floor. She stepped over the pirate ship and a line of warriors on motorbikes, and found him curled up in his bed, the duvet completely covering his head. She pulled the duvet back a little and stroked his hair, then kissed his warm cheek. His eyelids half opened, and his lips formed a smile before he was sound asleep again. Her own room was usually tidier than Bobby's, except she was sorting through her belongings in preparation for the new baby, who would sleep in a cot next to her. The floor space was covered with boxes and bags of old clothes that she'd hauled out of cupboards, stuff that she'd amassed over the years. Some of it could go up into the loft, but she was determined that at least half of it should go straight to the recycling bin or to a charity shop. It was a work in progress. She kept the shoebox containing Steve's letters close to her bedside table and counted 6 more boxes, none of them containing shoes. She picked up the nearest one to her and looked at the label. The edges were curled and peeling, the writing illegible. She opened it up and found all sorts of mementos that she'd kept from her childhood. A concert ticket stub, an essay she'd got 95% for, a postcard from when she'd gone to Wales with Lydia's parents. Lydia. Tess smiled at the memory of their friendship. She was her one true friend back when they were in their teens. Tess would never forget the first time she saw her, and suddenly, the whole world shifted on its axis. She couldn't believe it when Lydia had wanted to be her friend. The sun had finally risen on her life. She was someone. Lydia Green had singled her out. Not for the first time, she wondered where Lydia was now and how she'd spent her life these last 30 years. 1991. They first met when they were both 13. Lydia arrived in Tess's class on a damp winter's day when the sun was low and the air chilled. It was Tess's third year of attending the girls' grammar school, a red sandstone building with four fairy tale towers, one at each corner. First day back after the Christmas holidays, and Miss Humble, the headmistress, was standing at the door to welcome them. Her nose was sharp. Her eyes narrow and cold. Her mouth was a thin, straight line made for mockery. Tess half-smiled a good morning and scurried past her to her form room, while Miss Humble's eyes narrowed in on a girl who was wearing makeup. Her classmates embraced the cliché of female stereotypes. At one end, there was Elizabeth, a kind, gentle, straight-A student with blonde hair, blue eyes, and one of those faces that seemed always to be smiling. She walked with a bounce in her step, as if the ground was softer on her than it was on the rest of them. Tess wanted to hate her, but she never could. It would have been like hating the sun.
"Hi, Tess. How was your Christmas?" Elizabeth asked her.
"Great, thanks."
She dumped her bag on the desk and tried to smile like she meant it.
"Lots of presents and family fun."
She circled the flat of her hand above her belly and widened her eyes.
"Way too much food."
Elizabeth laughed.
"It doesn't show on you. You're lucky that way."
"How's Tess lucky?"
Karen asked. She was sitting on top of another desk, legs crossed, one foot revolving at the ankle, and she was thrusting out her boobs like there were boys in the room. She was at the other end of the girl spectrum, a regular little witch. She was where the spite took shape and the oil boiled.
"We were talking about Christmas," Elizabeth told her,
her tone upbeat.
"How was yours, Karen?"
Karen didn't bother to reply. She had little time for Elizabeth. Perfection was smooth. There were no threads to pull nor buttons to press. Karen stared Tess up and down, then leaned towards the girl beside her, whispering something that made her snigger. Tess felt her cheeks flame and she turned away, rummaging purposefully in her bag, as if she could be rescued by what was in there. Their form teacher was called Miss Richards, and she was one of the teachers who believed in them, no matter how uncooperative or obnoxious they were. When she'd given them a few minutes to catch up, she clapped her hands and they settled into their places.
"Lovely to see you all, girls." She smiled round at them. "Tomorrow morning, we'll share our New Year's resolutions, but for now you need to choose your enrichment class."
She was handing out slips of paper as she spoke.
"You'll need permission from your parents for sailing, as there is an added charge for that. All the other options are free."
On Friday afternoon, they were timetabled for enrichment, which wasn't so much enriching as confusing or anxiety-inducing, or just plain boring, depending on the subject and the teacher. There were 10 activities on the list. Tess searched for the lesser of the evils. Her mum's boyfriend had recently moved into their house with his daughter Saskia, who was in the parallel form.
Tess knew she'd choose drama, so that was one for her to avoid. Chess was a no-no because the teacher was a young man with a nervous tic, and that made her feel sorry for him. French conversation was dire. She'd tried that last term. Karen and her witches always chose it because the teacher was depressed and the class ran rings around her. Hockey might have been worthwhile, but the teacher was male, young and fit, and he sent her pulse sky high. She became a giggly, sycophantic mess. She ticked the box for school newspaper. The sixth formers hogged the writing and editing, but she knew they'd send her to the library to fact check for them, and that suited her fine. When they'd handed back their completed slips of paper, Miss Richards said, "Oh, one other thing before you head off. We have a new girl joining the class today. She'll be arriving first lesson." That set off an expectant buzz, the girl's eyes darting and rolling. Where was she from? What was she like? How would she fit in? The bell rang, and they made their way to the language department. The corridors were long and cold. The windows had wooden frames that were warped in places so that the moisture leaked inside and formed thin layers of ice on the panes. The radiators didn't work properly. They made a show of creaking and wailing, but never grew warm. Keeping their coats on, the girls clustered together, trying on each other's hats and scarves. Some scraped their chairs across the floor to the windows, where their breath condensed on the glass, and they drew love hearts, twinning their initials with boys from the boys' grammar school. Mr. Salisbury was 5 minutes late. When he came striding into the room, his hair was disheveled and his expression pained. They knew from the grapevine that he was going through a divorce. He'd caught his wife having sex with the hockey teacher. Yes, really. And another reason Tess could never choose hockey for enrichment. She enjoyed languages, and Latin, although technically dead as a dodo, interested her. She liked making connections between the words of old and their current vocabulary. She could lose herself for hours reading random pages in the dictionary. And that was a secret because she'd have had the piss ripped out of her if anyone knew, even more so by her family than the likes of Karen. The teacher rapped a wooden pointer on his desk.
Ecce Romani.
They rummaged in their bags and pulled out textbooks. Every copy was old and tatty. If there were more modern texts, then they hadn't reached their school yet. He named the page and then his glance fell to the right.
Tess Carter, conjugate the verb perfect subjunctive, please.
She focused on the page.
Marva im, Marva is, Marva.
The door opened. 25 pairs of eyes swiveled towards it. The winter sun was behind the new girl as she walked in. Her shoes were lace-up, with 2.5-inch heels and scuffed at the toes. Black tights raced up long legs. Skirt smooth from the waist to the top of her thighs, where it lapped into pleats that shimmied as she walked. Her grey shirt was pulled tight over breasts that belonged to a woman. Her hair was blonde, short and spiky, with gothic black running through it. Wide green eyes, summer grass, Christmas trees, the silvery sheen of snakeskin, and a smile to knock the lid from a coffin. Tess stared at her. Everyone stared at her, while she glanced around, drawing conclusions with a slight tilt of her head, a minute raising of her eyebrows. The teacher banged his book on the desk and glared.
"You must be Lydia Green."
A surname to match her eyes, Tess thought.
"And you must be Mr. Salisbury."
She flicked him a smile up through her lashes, like Princess Diana with attitude.
"Well, sit down then, Lydia Green."
Lydia wafted in Tess's direction and slid into the seat beside her. Tess held her breath.
"Did you study Latin in your last school?"
the teacher called out. Of course, she smiled back. Tess inhaled, discovered that Lydia smelled of vanilla and sugar, peppermint and an underlying whiff of tobacco. Lydia turned towards her. Is it always this cold? She asked. They'll have the heating working by the spring, Tess replied, her voice a whisper. Lydia rested her chin on her hand, and when Tess met her eyes, she felt a great bobsleigh ride. Greased runners, hot friction on cold ice that drove into the pit of her stomach. I think we're going to be friends, Lydia said. Lydia. So far, so manageable. We'd been living in Ashdown Village for one whole week. I stayed close to home, so close to home that I hadn't gone beyond the garden. I was getting through each day 1 minute at a time, jumping out of my skin if the doorbell rang, and peering through the window from just behind the curtain if I heard a noise outside. Adam had started at his new school and was loving it. Zach drove him there, and when he returned home, he'd make us both a coffee and tell me about the parents he'd met. We have a dinner invite, he told me on the Friday. Already? You must be making an impression. They're friendly in the country. I raised my eyebrows at this. I was unpacking one of the boxes, transferring hats and scarves, gloves and rain jackets to the hall cupboard. Unpacking was taking me forever, but I wouldn't let Zach help me because it was giving me a reason to stay at home. The cleaner's coming at 10:30 to give us a quote, he said, checking the diary on his phone. She's called Vanya. She works for a company called Maids of Honor. Nothing to do with weddings. Their cleaning products are environmentally friendly. Great, I smiled. Or tried to. A few seconds of silence swelled the air. Mum was really hoping to see you today, Zach said, his tone questioning. I nodded. And I want to see her. She really loves you, Lydia. And I love her too. I just need to be sure that I'm over the stomach bug. I stared down into the box, wincing at the lie. I didn't have a stomach bug. My stomach was upset because I was anxious. It churned and grumbled constantly, as if eating itself. Lydia? His voice was loud, and I looked up with a start. He took a pile of scarves from me and put them on the shelf. We won't need any of this for at least a month. Please just leave the unpacking for a bit. Then he held me in his arms, tight but not too tight. It made me want to cry. Sorry. I pulled away before my heart burst and all the anguish spilled out. I'm just not sleeping very well. It's like you're permanently in a daze. They do say moving house is one of life's main stressors. I took a steadying breath. You know what? I will go and see your mum today. I nodded to convince myself. If you don't mind staying in for the cleaner. He hugged me again. I can do that. The drive to the hospice was a straight road with a couple of right turns, but I went the long way round so that I didn't have to pass through the streets that were familiar to my teenage self. Still, I kept looking over my shoulder, checking for ghosts that I was sure were lurking at the corners of my vision. Just because I didn't see any, that didn't mean they weren't there. The hospice was bright and welcoming, not hospice-like at all. Or not what I had imagined, anyway. A lavender scent hung in the air, and I could hear laughter at the end of the corridor. I'd been to visit Paula once before when we came down to look at houses, so I knew the way to her room. It was large and light, with three easy chairs and a door to an ensuite. The view through the window showed off the forest in all its glory, every shade of green stretching to the distant horizon. Paula was propped semi-upright in a large hospital bed, medical equipment and Adam's drawings adorning the wall behind her. Her eyes were closed, and that gave me the chance to absorb the changes in her. She had lost so much weight since I had last seen her, her shape slight beneath the thin cotton sheet. Her hair was wispy and sparse, a pale imitation of the black curls that had set her apart. Her skin had a translucent quality that reminded me of insects' wings. Adam had gone through a phase of briefly trapping wasps and flies in a magnifying glass jar. We had examined the membranous, glittering wings with fascination before releasing the insects to fly again. It struck me that dying took us back to the natural world. As adults, we outsourced, avoided, did everything we could to deny our own mortality. We kept ourselves firmly at the top of the food chain, as if we were exempt from death. She opened her eyes, and they lit up at once.
Lydia.
She reached out her hands to clasp hold of mine.
How long have you been standing there?
Not long. I bent to kiss her cheek.
I'm constantly nodding off. I don't know what's wrong with me.
She frowned and pretended to think.
Oh, no, wait a minute, I do.
She laughed. Her sense of humor had always been on the darker side.
I spent years as an insomniac, and now I do nothing but sleep.
I pulled one of the chairs close to the bed and sat down. I'm sorry I haven't been to see you for a few weeks. The move and every... I shook my head. Paula was someone who saw through bullshit, and I was sure a cancer diagnosis hadn't changed that. I have no excuse, Paula. I've just been... I stopped again, lost for words. I couldn't tell her a lie. I couldn't tell her the truth, and there were no words that balanced on the tightrope in between.
Lydia, you have nothing to apologize for.
Her hands sought mine again.
I know how places like this can be a trigger.
Her voice dropped.
Losing your dad at 16 could not have been easy.
I was staring down at our combined hands, too afraid to meet her eyes. Little did Paula know that my dad had died in this very village and was buried in the churchyard.
And I know how much you loved living in London. Moving here must be tough on you. I tried to get Zach to drop the idea, but you know what he's like when he gets a bee in his bonnet.
I looked up then. We all wanted to be closer to you, Paula, really.
Thank you, my dear.
A tear trickled down her cheek.
Runny eye.
She wiped it with the back of her hand.
Or is it a roomy eye now that I'm an old lady?
Stop it, I laughed. You'll never be old. You're far too sharp.
If only.
She gave me a wistful smile.
Oh, before I forget, I want to thank you for all your messages. I so look forward to them. They're a window on the world. And Adam, what a treasure he is.
He's had his best week ever. I told her about how much he was enjoying his new school, and one subject led to another until almost 2 hours had gone by, and I could see that Paula was beginning to flag. I'm going to leave you in peace now, I told her.
It's been such a treat seeing you.
She looked at the clock on her bedside table.
I have time for a little nap before they bring me lunch. It's like the Ritz. We had smoked salmon yesterday.
Zach's been telling me about Jenny and how kind she is, I said, lifting the chair back to its spot by the window. And Adam tells me she makes good shortbread.
Yes, she is kind. She's a widow like me.
She rested her head back on the pillows.
She comes in the afternoons,
Her eyes closed. I'll be back very soon. I kissed her cheek and whispered, thank you for being so lovely. I walked to my car, feeling both happy and sad. I was going to miss Paula, and I was only just realizing how much. As I turned the key in the ignition, I wondered whether I should challenge myself. I could, couldn't I? I could drive home the easiest route, pass by her house, if it was still her house, see whether she was living there. Would she still be there after 30 years? Would I be tempting fate by even looking? He who hesitates is lost, as my dad used to say, and thinking of my dad, I knew where I needed to go first, before anywhere else. I should never have put it off this long. I drove the couple of miles into Ashdown Village and parked in a side street. It was almost lunchtime and people were drifting towards the cafes and the wine bar. Back in the day, the wine bar had been a bank, but now, Paula had told me, there were no banks and a dozen places to buy coffee, from the hairdressers to the bookshop. A few weeks after I met Zach, I spoke to him about my dad passing away and how I'd moved in with my aunt. My mum and I had never been close, and I'd lost touch with her. We talked of my dad often because I wanted more than anything to keep him alive in my heart. I walked a thin line in terms of revealing some information, but not too much, just enough to keep Zach interested without him asking too many questions. I had never once mentioned where my dad was buried, and he had never asked. I opened the wrought iron gate and walked into the graveyard next to the church. It was a hodgepodge of resting places, the contours of the graves aligning with the rise and fall of the land. I followed the brick pathway past the weather-beaten headstones, some of them tilting sideways and overgrown with moss, the dedications no longer legible. There had been an adding of graves through the decades, extra portions of land tacked on, but my dad was buried halfway between the church and the perimeter. I remembered my mother choosing the plot. I stopped in front of his gravestone and read the inscription. Adam Green, 12-12-1950 to 30-7-1994. Beloved husband to Genevieve and father to Lydia. May he rest in peace. My hands began to shake. I gripped my fists tight by my side and concentrated on breathing. It was 30 years since my dad had died, and not a day had gone by when I hadn't thought of him. Coming back to the village had one silver lining. It meant I would be able to visit his resting place, to talk to him, to explain things to him, to ask for forgiveness. All of this too late, of course. My head knew this, but my heart hoped he would hear me. Tess. Are you all right? Vanya asked, nudging her shoulder. They were standing at the edge of the pitch, watching their children play in a football match. You look sad. I'm sorry. Tess stifled a yawn. I was up late last night writing an advert for the local magazine, so now I'm tired. And when I'm tired, it's hard for me to stop thinking about Steve.
Oh, Tess.
Vanya's expression was kind. I can work an extra few hours this week, if that helps.
Thanks, Vanya. She sighed. I wish I could just somehow.
She struggled to find the right words. Fast forward. Through this grief.
It's only been 7 months.
Vanya gave her a sideways hug, her front arm resting above Tess's baby bump.
Don't be so hard on yourself.
She held her for several beats before she pulled back and said,
shall I get us a drink?
Please.
Coffee?
She pointed to the bump. Coffee gives me terrible reflux. A mint tea, if they have one. Vanya went into the clubhouse, and Tess shielded her eyes with her hand as she searched for Bobby on the football field. He was across the other side, tackling a player in the opposing team. He was concentrating hard, his attention fixed on the ball as he gained possession and ran the length of the pitch. His shot at goal ricocheted off the bar, and his shoulders briefly slumped before he ran back into position.
Nice try, Bobby,
the coach shouted, and Tess clapped along with the other parents before her hand strayed back to her bump, cupping it protectively. Life wasn't all bad. Her days were punctuated with pockets of joy. Bobby's smile, so like his dad's. His optimism a constant, even although he was grieving too.
Thing is, Mum, he told her, I had my dad for more than 9 years, so I'll always remember him, and that's more than lots of children get.
He stared up at her with bright, earnest eyes.
Some children never have a dad, not even for a minute.
If a 9-year-old could count his blessings, then why couldn't she? Tess glanced behind her and saw Vanya close to the clubhouse, holding 2 takeout cups and chatting to a group of mums. They lived in a village where everyone knew everyone. Incomers were quickly spotted and welcomed. She'd clocked the unfamiliar car in the car park when they arrived. It was hard to miss. A gunmetal grey 4x4, huge and squat, like an oversized beetle. There was a new boy in the team, Bobby had told her. He'd met him at the practice session midweek.
He's called Adam, and he's really nice, Mum. He used to live in London, but they moved here to be close to his grandma.
The woman with her back to her must be his mum. She was wearing a knee-length white cotton dress and a denim jacket, with strappy sandals tied at the ankles. She stood with one hip slightly forward, her face turned away from Tess, her hands moving through the air in a graceful arc as she spoke. Tess felt the nudge of something familiar, but swiveled back to the pitch when she heard Maisie call out,
Adam, over here.
Vanya's daughter Maisie, the team's captain, was several meters away, her arms waving above her head so that Adam could locate her. Tess moved back a step as he thundered down the wing and came to an abrupt stop in front of her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.